first, I'd like to thank the organizers for inviting me here to speak. And yeah, my topic is going to be movement-related information conveyed by non-traditional signal sources in motor cortex. So this is the neurotechnology session, and the technology I'd like to talk about today are brain-computer interfaces. Now, I'm sure most of you are familiar with the concept, and the idea is that we want to take a patient who has lost the ability to move either through spinal cord injury or brainstem stroke, something like this, and we want to tap out the intention to move out of signals in motor cortex and then use that to directly activate, in this case, a cursor on a computer screen and give that person direct access to the external world. And so here we have a monkey who's using the activity of about 30 neurons to push a cursor around on a computer screen in 2D. So the way these devices work is as follows. We can take microelectrode arrays, we can implant them in primary motor cortex and record some tens to possibly hundreds of neurons in primary motor cortex and record the action potentials of those neurons, which I've denoted here as these vertical tick marks. And then if we understand how these neurons represent intended movement, we can build a mapping between neurons and cursor movement using some kind of decoding algorithm, and then we present that mapping in the form of cursor movement, and the subject sees that cursor movement and can gradually learn to control it as he wishes. So naturally, to do this, we have to understand a little bit about how neurons represent movement naturally. And the landmark experiment for this was actually done about 3 decades ago by Georgopoulos and colleagues, where they recorded from single neurons in motor cortex as monkeys made two-dimensional center-out reaching movements with their arm, where they moved it from the center of a workspace to targets equally spaced around a circle on the outside. And what Georgopoulos noticed is that the neurons responded in a lawful manner. Most of them had some kind of preferred direction where they would fire maximally, and then they had some kind of anti-preferred direction where they would stop firing in response to that movement. And if you plotted the firing rate as a function of the direction of that movement, it would obey this nice lawful cosine tuning curve. Now, people have repeated these experiments and looked for other things that neurons tune for, and in fact, they tune for a lot of motor parameters. Here's one example of this done by Moran and Schwartz back in 1999, where they showed that in addition to tuning for direction, these cells also had strong tuning to movement speed. So knowing things about with our advanced knowledge about how neurons are representing movement, the technology behind brain-computer interfaces has gotten much better over the years. And this is a movie out of Andy Schwartz's lab, where now we have a monkey and he's controlling a 7-degree-of-freedom robotic limb. So he's controlling the 3-dimensional endpoint position of that limb. He's orienting the wrist in 3 degrees of freedom. He's got flexion, extension, abduction and adduction and rotation of the wrist. And then he's also controlling the gripper of the fingers. And he's using that limb to grab that target spaced, presented in various locations. Now, there's a clinical trial going on right now at the University of Pittsburgh where they have a patient implanted with microelectrodes in primary motor cortex, and she's using a limb that's exactly like this and learning to use it to move around. And they've experienced, she's gotten control of 7 degrees of freedom and occasionally as many as 10 degrees of freedom, different types of hand shapes she's able to control. And that's been published. It came out recently. It was this past year. What you may not know